So we're about to start our interplanetary journey in the medium of Duke Ellington in the vehicle of Holst. And in the way of Ellington Inner Suite, I've cast the members of the orchestra, the soloists, in roles appertaining to the characters in the planets. So we're going to start with the Blues in Orbit, an Ellington original, interspersed into the rest of the suite, as Ellington would do, recycling a piece of older material. This is the appropriately titled Blues in Orbit, and it enables us to hear a pre-flight announcement from our pilot, Chris Traves, master of the talking plunger trombone. And now we're leaving Earth's orbit and speeding off towards the Sun and the nearest planet, Mercury. But lo, who's this with fluttering wings and flugelhorn a-go-go? Yes, it's young James Davison, the winged messenger, doing his best to give us his impression of Clark Terry, Duke Ellington's mercurial flugelhorn player, on Mercury. That was Mercury. And now we move to Venus, the soothing romantic world of the Greek perception of Venus, the bringer of peace, not the actual Venus, the frothing globe of poisonous chemicals and gas that would kill from 1,000 paces. No, the actual Greeks had a vision of this, and to make it soothing and romantic, we go to the colour in the Ellington palette of soothingness and romanticism, which would be the alto saxophone of Johnny Hodges, recreated here by Colin Skinner. Colin, the bringer of peace. Venus, romantic, calm, and pellucid. And so on to Mars. Now, of course, Mars, the bringer of war in Greco-Roman pantheistic tradition, but of course, we live in the post-Flash Gordon, Star Trek, Star Wars era, so our Mars, the bringer of war, is a proper space panto baddie, a nasty cross between Ming the Merciless and Darth Vader, and in fact, Stavros, King of the Daleks. All three rolled into one hideous, screaming unity by Louis Dowdwell and his trumpet of mass destruction. So that was Mars, strutting around his castle shouting, "Fools, I'll destroy you all." And of course now, onto Jupiter. Now, orchestrationally, Jupiter has four melodies, four beautiful melodies, none of which could be omitted from this work. But of course, with each member of the orchestra being one of the personalities, Jupiter had to be Jay Craig, who naturally is the bringer of jollity anyway, in real life, as well as in our little series of vignettes. But I didn't want Jay to play four tunes in a row, so we've got Jupiter split into sort of two segments. Jupiter itself, played by Jay Craig, more of which later. But this first thing, the asteroids, okay? So the picture is we're leaving Mars. To get from Mars to Jupiter, as we now know, you have to fly through the asteroid belt. Holst didn't know this, but I've kind of painted a Star Trek-like picture with Calamau on trombone and Mike Hall on tenor as the Sulu and Chekhov of our spaceship, navigating and helmsmaning their way through the asteroid belt, that as the asteroids get more and more frantic, eventually they have to send the ship through all kinds of twists and turns. You hear them trying to sing their songs as the asteroids come in thick and fast, until in the end they have to get the spacesuits on and go out onto the surface of the ship and bat the asteroids off. Callum has, of course, a laser machine gun, But Mike, being a bit slower on the uptake, only has a stuffed badger to bat them off with. He tries his best. And then, of course, all the asteroids are cleared, the chums win, the motor starts up, and off we go to Jupiter. We approach the orbit of Jupiter, where we beam down to the surface with the Mambo piano introduction, where Jay Craig, the bringer of jollity, is standing there, his party table groaning with plenty, as we end up in a Latin American and swing bacchanalian knees up. But of course, the big moment of Jupiter in the original is the hymn, so it falls to Jay to give us the spiritual address, which ends in a very moving way with the beautiful baritone sax set against the softly moving saxophones. And then, of course, we have to be away. We're on a voyage through the planets, so we beam out of orbit and leave Jupiter, and we hear Jay waving goodbye from the planet's surface, just him and the chuckling piano. And now, the Link Man's nightmare. The one which wasn't any problem on the television until about 1998, when the Voyager probe started taking close-up pictures of it, and we had to have Trevor McDonald pronouncing it in a most unusual way 9 times every news broadcast. Of course, the character for this particular planet is Colin Good, because he is the magician. The magician is the character for this planet, and the magicians in our case are Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn, who made all that magic happen in the big band idiom for all those years. So, as they both played the piano, I thought it appropriate that Colin would play 2 solos in this piece, 1 in the language of each. And it's now our pleasure to have Colin Good play you Uranus. Uranus. And now to the final of Holst's original planets, Neptune. Oh, beautiful Neptune, as he saw it on the far rim of the solar system before we jump into the indigo abyss of the rest of space. Ironically, Neptune doesn't really have a tune, should be called no tune really, but it is a beautiful shifting set of moods and colours, and as a pastel venture into the far reaches of space, it is without equal. So here we are, that's the end of Holst planets. But it's not the end of the planets, because in 1938, I believe, Pluto was discovered. Now Pluto isn't discovered anymore, they don't think it's a planet, but they did then. And so it gives me an excuse to do something that Ellington would have done in the 60s when putting a suite together. Often, Ellington would turn to his writing companion Billy Strayhorn when they were having a suite, and they'd get something out of the Billy Strayhorn treasure chest that hadn't been recorded. A famous example of this would be the Star-Crossed Lovers in the Shakespeare suite, or Isfahan in the Far East suite. Beautiful tunes just lying around in Strayhorn's treasure chest. And for this one, I managed to secure a Strayhorn composition from 1944 called Le Sacre Suprême, which we have representing Pluto. It has to be called Le Sacre Suprême because that's what Strayhorn called it. He's not here to call it Pluto, but we can say it represents Pluto in the Ellingtonian suite manner. And we can, however, put an Ellingtonian spin on it and give it a story and a character. Pluto, as you know, is the end of our solar system, if we decide it's a planet. Ooh. And, of course, that means it's the gateway to the rest of the universe, Pluto. So it needs a gatekeeper. Now, because of a big mess-up at the land registry, Pluto is under the control of New Malden Town Council. And our trumpet player, Ryan Quigley, lives in Malden, which is part of that town council. And so for 3 weekends every year, he has to go and keep the gate on Pluto. They sort of fly him out, and it's all kind of hush-hush, but he does it on the side for a bit of extra money. And also, along with the gatehouse that he has to run, there's the bar. They're very understaffed on Pluto, as you can imagine. And they have the sort of the weird space bar with, you know, with the waitresses with six, you know, six. And octopuses playing cards and so forth, and big blue drinks with smoke coming out the top. It's one of those bars. And Ryan runs that. So the portrayal of the gatekeeper in Pluto is the man who has to sternly watch the gate whilst welcoming people into the bar. A little bit of an oxymoron. And as Ryan himself is a little bit of an oxymoron, that's nice. Thanks for listening to all of these. It's a funny old year putting it together. It came to me in a car ride listening to Venus, funnily enough, on Classic FM. And it just struck me that Venus was a tune that could have been written by Billy Strayhorn, and then the whole of the rest of the idea unfolded during that car journey, because the drive to Swaffham is a long and lonely pilgrimage.